are soldiers of freedom. Super Earth is their home. Democracy their creed. They are the Helldivers. And they need you. Travel the galaxy. Visit foreign worlds. And encounter exotic life forms. Modest, noble inhabitants in dire need of liberation. Spread democracy. Bring safety, prosperity, and justice throughout the stars. Command tomorrow's most sophisticated and overwhelming firepower. Superior, reliable, and safe. Become heroes of the Federation. Work together, coordinate your fire, and trust your teammates. So ready your arms. Prepare for planetfall and bring democracy to the universe once and for all. Don't wait. Enlist today.
All right. Hello, everybody, and welcome to opnoobs.com, PC gaming by PC gamers. We've got a great interview this morning. Today we have with us Mr. Johan Pilestedt. He's from Arrowhead Games. We're very excited to have him today. On the call, we also have with us our very own Colt Cortejas. Colt, thanks for being with us this morning. And gentlemen, welcome to the show. All right. So Johan is the CEO and game director of Arrowhead Games. They have recently released Helldivers for the PC. That's a great twin-stick shooter that was on the PlayStation 3 as well as the PlayStation 4. I've had a chance to play it. I know Colt's had a chance to play it. So we're very excited to talk to Mr. Pilestedt here today about that game. We've also got a few other questions about Gauntlet as well as Magicka in the pipeline. So I hope everyone back home is very excited to hear about that. So first off, Mr. Pilestedt, thank you for being on the show with us today. Usually, before we get started talking about yourself and about your game and your studio, we'd like to know a little bit about you. You know, what did you grow up playing? And how did you come about being a games developer?
Well, first of all, hello, interwebs. It's customary to say interwebs, I've heard.
Indeed, yes.
Well, that is quite an interesting story. Well, it's not. Okay, I'm the regular nerd. I mean, I grew up playing a lot of pen and paper role-playing games, played a lot of tabletop games, you know, a lot of board games. Then, of course, got into computer games and console games at a very early age. I think I was like 6 when I got my first Nintendo Entertainment System. I was so thrilled. I tried playing Mario with... I tried to jump in Mario with by sort of like pulling the controller upwards. I remember that very clearly. And, I mean, 30 years later, Nintendo caught up and made that possible.
That's very true.
But I mean, I've been a huge Zelda fan all my life. Played some StarCraft. Loved that game as general concept. I mean, the 3 different alien races doing battle. Huge fan of a lot of strategy games, actually, like Dune, Dark Colony, if anybody remembers that old game for PC. Played a ton of Half-Life, and that's actually how I got into games development. Yeah, I was a modder for Half-Life. Nice. Was part of the Day of Defeat team back in the days.
You were? No kidding. I played a ton of Day of Defeat back in the day.
Yeah, I actually joined that team. I was a bit... If mods were women, and I were a guy, which I am, I guess, I would have been the biggest player in the world, because I joined every mod team I could get my hands on, because I just loved mods. I just couldn't get enough of them.
So you don't actually know how many little mod babies you might have out there.
I have no idea. I don't even want to know. But I joined the Day of Defeat team because I thought the mod looked so fucking great. Am I allowed to say fucking?
Only a few times.
Okay. I'm not used to that. I swear a lot.
We're not G-rated here, but we try to be a family-friendly show.
Oh, okay. Sorry,
it's 9 o'clock in the morning in Nashville, so.
Yeah. So this could be a children's show.
That's right. That's right. And it's a snow day, so everyone's at home. I'm kidding. You know, continue.
I'm gonna lay off the cursing for a while. So, back in the days, I joined a lot of mod teams just to be able to play the game. I mean, I knew modeling and I knew level design, and I always had this knack for game design as well. But I joined my mod teams primarily to be able to play them with my friends, because I was tired of old games out there, and I always had this idea that modders knew exactly what gamers wanted, because it was made by gamers, more so than the fortunate few that were able to make a living as a game developer. Mm. So I joined, for instance, the Day of Defeat team as a level designer, really wanted to play that game.
And how old were you when you worked on Day of Defeat?
Like 15, 16, maybe?
Yeah, I was going to say, you must be, because I remember playing that. I was, I think I was 14 or 15 when that came out. So, Yeah,
but I started at a really early age. Only because I got this magazine about 3D dinosaurs that somebody had created in 3D Studio Max. So I pirated that. I downloaded the software and started modeling on my own because I thought the dinosaurs were so cool. And then I got into games development, of course. But yeah, so I joined Day of Defeat. They weren't nearly at the stage of what their promotion told the community that they were at. So I got a bit tired of that. I was like, well, this game is never ever gonna be anything. This mod is never ever gonna be released. So I quit that team, and after that they got this really like a huge second wind, and they just threw it out there. So I quit before they even had the chance to release anything.
Because I remember being able to purchase that game in game stores at one point. You could buy Day of Defeat, a boxed copy of Day of Defeat, which was crazy that you could buy a boxed copy of a mod ever. Yeah. But Counter-Strike, I remember you could buy.
Yeah, I mean, it was. That era, that boosted me into the games industry. I mean, I was also part of the natural selection team back in the days. Did some of the first-person view models, and that team was fucking brilliant. They were really, really good guys. But as usual, I have a very short attention span, and I think at any given point, I was at least a part of four different mod teams simultaneously. So didn't really work out that well. The one mod that I stick with for longest was Frontline Force for Half-Life. It's a bit of an unknown mod, but it was basically a reimagining of the early screenshots of what Team Fortress 2 would be, like the military kind of look. And that team sort of fell apart after the project lead got hired by Valve, so sort of crippled the team when he was the one driving the entire development and the only one programming as well.
That's too bad.
But I mean, it was a wonderful experience, and it's probably the best days of my life, because I went to high school, came home, slept, went to bed really early, and then woke up so that I would be on US time, so I came with all the devs in the US, and then I stayed up all night, went to high school, went back home, and went to bed.
Oh my gosh, you must have been exhausted all the time.
No, it wasn't. I mean, it was a weird way of living your life. But I mean, my parents were really supportive. My father has always been super interested in technology and everything related to computers. So he knew he sort of knew what it was all about. It was a really nice time. And I kept modding until I was like 20 something. Attended a college for game development, which weirdly was founded by, the actual major was started by my mother's cousin. You know, Sweden, we're all, everybody's cousin to somebody. not really, but he was sort of like the person that I played games with the most. I mean, he was a college professor, and when I was 6 years old and I got my Nintendo, he came over like a couple of months later, and he sat down and played the original Zelda, and he was like instantly hooked. And he was like 50 at that time, or like 45 or something. And he was so hooked that he went home, bought a Nintendo Entertainment System, a new TV, and placed it in what would be his new man cave.
That's awesome.
He got so into it that he actually talked the college into creating an education specifically tailored for game development.
Wow. And you later took that program.
Yeah. And that's so cool. It was all right, but what happened is that I met a lot of people, a lot of nice people, and five of them are co-owners of Arrowhead right now. So we dropped out of college and started the studio back then, and we even talked.
I saw that on your LinkedIn that you had started Arrowhead in 2009, but you graduated in 2010. Is that correct?
Yeah, well, I never graduated.
No. did they give you an honorary degree, or you just kind of put that on there?
No, I mean, Sweden is sort of a Germanic country. You need to do the bureaucracy to get you can't get an honorary title.
Gotcha. That's funny. That's pretty awesome, though. I mean, it's very impressive. It sounds like you were just really steeped in your work at a young age, and that you kept with it all through college and got a great degree, and now you just seem to be storming the independent gaming front. And I mean, I think that's a great segue right into sort of how you started Arrowhead and what that took.
Yeah, I mean, when we started the company, that was a mess, an utter mess. We tried to, the story goes like this, and it's such a weird thing. I mean, we had some guys that came up to do a lecture at the college I was studying at, and they were from a Swedish game development competition called Swedish Game Awards. And they came by the campus and had this lecture about, like, well, if you apply for this, you have the chance of winning the grand prize pool of $4,000 or whatever it was. And you also get recognized as a game developer. And the weird thing about this is that they had this lecture like halfway through the competition. So I sat down with one of my friends back in college called Emil, and said to him, like, we really should be part of that. We need to make a game. And he was like, yeah, I'm all up for making a game. I mean, the courses are boring right now. So it was like some traditional art and film theory or whatever. So we wanted to develop games, but there was something else in the way. So we started developing a game with a couple of guys that we knew at college. And we always had a mentality when we were developing that game, like, we're going to make it the best game in the universe. We're going to not only win Game of the Year in this competition, but we're going to go on and win Game of the Year in every magazine that has ever existed. And that was actually the prototype for Magicka. So we won Swedish Game Awards, surprisingly enough. It came as a bit of a shock to us at that time, but we set out to do what we really wanted to do. And then just before we went back to college, one of the judges who were part of the Swedish games industry, I mean, there are designers from Starbreeze and Avalanche and DICE and so forth, that were the judges for this competition. One of them said to us, okay, whatever you guys do, don't let this slip through your hands, through your fingers, because that's something that a lot of people do. They get this great opportunity and they just don't do anything with it.
Yeah.
I looked at Emil and said, like, wow, we're not going to do that. We're going to, when we get back, we're going to finish this game and release it on Steam. So we went back to college. Took a couple of courses, kept studying, and six months later, we're like, what have we done? We didn't continue to develop this game at all. So at that point, we're like, okay, we need to drop out. We're going to drop out. We're going to pursue this. We're going to live on crackers and pasta, pretty much. So we went to our dean, and we wanted a sanity check. So we went to our dean and said, like, yeah, we're thinking about dropping out of college since we won this award, and we're thinking about starting a new company or starting a company. And he's like, yeah, that's the sensible thing to do.
Call a college. I told you to do it.
You can always come back and finish your studies if everything goes to shit. It's like, well, okay. We thought we would get this long speech about how to not drop out of college from our dean, but it was like, oh, you should totally do it. And we're like, okay, well, we probably need a second opinion about this. So we went to our student, it's called career counselor, and she was like, you should probably drop out.
So you can tell that these people have a lot of faith in their own college. I mean,
I think
it's better off not being here than being here.
It's so weird. So we were like, okay, where do we start? And we, the college put us into this incubator where we got a lot of contacts with lawyers and whatnot that could help us guide through tax laws and a lot of stuff that we did not need to know. It just confused us and made us really scared about starting a company. But anyways, we started this company, started developing Magicka, said, like, well, we're probably going to be able to finish this game in 6 months using 6 developers.
And that turned out to be wrong, I take it.
Yeah, pretty much. It took you 2.5 years with 10 developers. So we're about 700% off on the estimates there. So at the end of those 6 months, and we had planned our financial situation according to that, we ran out of money, of course. So our food turned from like meatballs and, yeah, of course we're Swedish, it's meatballs. But yeah, it was meatballs, okay, pasta, and like potatoes and whatnot. And it just went, our diet turned more and more into bread as the time progressed.
Bread and ramen noodles, I take it.
Yeah, no, ramen, though, that was too expensive, man.
That's a luxury.
So eventually we went like, well, we need to do something about this situation. So we contacted Paradox, and they were like, we asked them for the insane amount of, I think it was $100,000, and we're like, that's more money than anybody will ever need to make a game. And we're like, we even haggled down our price a bit before we pitched it to them. And we went into the CEO CEO's room at Paradox and said, like, well, we want to make this game. We want $100,000. And he's like, yeah. Yeah, you can have that. It's like,
wow.
Wow, we got $100,000 just like that. And then we managed to develop the game for that amount until it was released. And it went on to sell, I think it's up to 3.6 million copies right now.
Wow. That's amazing. That's a great story.
Yeah, it was a crazy time. And the development period of Magicka, that was just insane. We worked so long hours. It was like 12-hour days on end.
And that was interesting, too, because I noticed when reading about Arrowhead, I saw that you had bounced between Sony and Paradox. And I guess I was curious about, because I know you had Sony backed you for Helldivers, Paradox backed you, I believe, for Gauntlet and also Magicka. Is that correct?
For Magicka and Showdown Effect. And,
oh, okay. Gauntlet
was Warner Brothers.
I did see that. Gauntlet was Warner Brothers. So you've actually bounced between 3 major publishers. I mean, really, Sony and Warner Brothers are huge, about as big as they come. And Paradox, I think I was just playing another Paradox game the other day. They did City Skylines, and they've been producing or publishing some pretty large titles recently. Has that been difficult bouncing between publishers, or has that been beneficial for you?
I think it's been really beneficial. I mean, we've learned a lot about the differences in publishers. So we signed with Paradox, imagined that this would be an awesome relationship. we signed the agreement with them without having a lawyer present, and that caused some differences in what we thought the agreement was. So our relationship with Paradox, I mean, with a game that is that that sells that amount of copies and makes the amount of profit that Magicka did, we sort of had differences in what we thought we would earn and what they earned. So we were pretty pretty young at that time as a studio, so we didn't fully understand the agreements we were signing. So that created like a pretty big friction between us and Paradox. And that's one of the reasons why we started looking for new publishers. And we were thought like, we need to sign with a bigger publisher. And we started looking at Sony and Warner Brothers. Those are the two that that we really wanted to work with. And we always had this idea that, a smaller publisher like Paradox is going to be more like intimate, it's going to be more friendly, it's going to be a better relationship on both ends. And the big publishers, they're going to just be demanding, they're going to tell us what to do, and we're just going to have to accept that. But the weird thing is that the when we signed with Warner Brothers, we had an awesome relationship. It was really nice people that were our producers and our biz devs. Everybody was really friendly, and we're like, this is not the way we've heard that the games industry works. Yeah. It's supposed to be, you know, Sauron cracking down on the...
Yeah, that's right. On you that's right, hobbits.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, please, sir, give us some money and we will develop for bread. And the same goes with Sony. I mean, we were like, yeah, those crazy Japs, they're gonna... Is Jap an insult word?
Well, in the United States, it used to be what we called them before World War II, but I think we'll let it slide.
Okay. Well, the Japanese publisher, there's so many words that in Swedish that are not derogatory, but in...
Oh, don't worry about it. I don't think anyone's going to be offended.
I don't want to offend anybody. And Sony as well, they were really friendly, and now we're super close with them. I mean, we're super happy with Sony, and we're really good friends with everybody over there at the particular studio that we're working with, that's the publisher, since they are then part of a larger entity, which is then part of a larger entity, which is then, in turn, owned by a larger entity. So, I mean, the corporate... structures, they're hard to understand, but the people that we work with are really genuine people. And it's something that you miss completely. You think of these large publishers as being the devil itself. But, I mean, we've had pretty much the same experience with all publishers. I mean, Paradox, they're really friendly and really nice people. Warner, they're amazing. And Sony, likewise. So, I mean, all in all, I mean, we've had a really nice time in the games industry.
Well, good. I mean, that's great to hear. There's obviously, I'm sure you've heard all the horror stories that come out of some publishers, like, you know, EA, and I know even Warner Brothers has taken a lot of flack for some of the stuff they did with the Batman games. So that's actually kind of nice to hear that maybe not all publishers are evil, and there's occasionally a good story to be had.
Yeah, but I think there's always a lot of. A lot of people think malevolence while it's just ignorance. It's a business decision, and it turns out to be sort of an evil decision for the person on the ground floor, but it's not really.
Right. It's more private.
But I mean, of course, sometimes when you get shafted, I mean, it's happened once or twice that we've had these horrible corporate decisions. Really ruining shit for us. Shit. Not use that word. But anyways, and it's like, why are people doing this to us? And you become this like whiny kid, pretty much. Like, oh no, don't do this. Why are you doing this? But I mean, all in all, you have to accept that there's other forces at work, and we're only in this industry to make
awesome games.
Hmm. I mean, that's the right mentality to have. I think also you've probably done a good job bargaining for yourselves and making sure that you don't get, taken over by any of these publishers. And I imagine having experience with three publishers will set you up really nicely down the road for your future endeavors. One thing we did obviously want to talk about was your latest game, Helldivers, which just came out on PC. Our very own Colt had a chance to review that game for OP Noobs. So I'm going to flip it over to Colt for a while, who's going to ask you a few questions about Helldivers. I myself had a chance to play it yesterday, and I thought it was a great time. I love the twin stick shooter, the classic sort of arcade retro feel that it has. But Colt, I'm going to flip it over to you to ask some questions about Helldivers. Over to you.
All right, Johan. Well, I guess my first question is, what really kind of brought you over from Magicka and the Showdown Effect into Helldivers? What was kind of the thought process that led you into making this particular game?
that's a really good question. And I like to, every time somebody asks me, what is Magicka? I say, it's a wizard suicide simulator. and then when people ask me, what's Helldivers? I say, it's a soldier suicide simulator. So I guess that's pretty much the way that our games transition is from being able to mess things up as something. But it, you know, every time you play a wizard in a game, you are, everybody says, every cutscene, every character in game says, you're awesome.
Yeah.
And when you're a soldier, everybody says, you're awesome. But we want to turn that on its head and say, well, if you're a wizard and you go out like on to the city square, is anybody going to believe you? Probably not. They're going to be like, you'd say you're a wizard, but from what I reckon, wizards are nothing but problem. And the same goes for the Helldivers as well. They're super space soldiers. But they're just a mess. I mean, it's a regular dude in an armor, and somebody tells him, you're an elite soldier, but he's not. He's really not. He's just this average dude that's supposed to be a hero, and he needs to live up to the name of hero. And I guess that's the way that our mentality internally at Arrowhead works, is that we like to create this sort of satire of what game characters usually are and take that into different genres. And the same goes for instance, for the Showdown Effect, where you're supposed to be an action hero, but, I mean, you mess up more than half of the time. And the same goes for Helldivers. You mess up more than you succeed. And the same goes for Magicka.
That is definitely true. I've lost count of how many times I've died now on Helldivers.
Has it been mostly by your own accord, the enemy's accord, or your friend's accord?
You know, that's hard to say.
Probably my own accord.
So another thing too I would love to ask, and I'm sure everyone would love to know, is the inspiration for Helldivers, in the general setting sense. I know you were mentioning earlier that you were really into StarCraft and such when you were younger. And it's hard not to draw comparisons between the three races in StarCraft and the three races in Helldivers. Mm. And so it would just be good to kind of hear what exactly, like, basically makes Helldivers tick from a world-building perspective.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, that's something that I've been struggling with quite a lot in general game development terms. I mean, I have my favorite franchises, the things that really got me into being the huge geek I am. I mean, I love Aliens, I love Starship Troopers, I love Warhammer 40K, there's a lot of these things that I could go on, but like it's Dune, etc. And when developing games, I mean, with Magicka, we basically thought that, okay, we're going to make a generic fantasy world, and we're going to have fun with that. And as time progressed, I mean, all of the game concepts that we created, I had this period where I tried to stay clear of anything I liked to create games. And what happened was I just came up with shitty ideas. It was just bad. So Helldivers, as it is just a collection of things that I love about fiction. It's Starship Troopers at its core, of course.
More Starship Troopers of the book than the TV than the movie, I would say. Just for you folks that know the book versus the movie, they're very different.
I love the Starship Troopers book, and everybody listening that hasn't not read Starship Troopers should read it. It's what is it, like 300 pages?
Yeah, and it's a much more serious book, and it's actually much more similar to Helldivers than anything you see in the movie.
And I mean, the three races perspective is, of course, it is partially inspired by StarCraft, which in turn is inspired by Warhammer 40,000. Right. So, I mean, it is stuff that I love. Being this epitome of a really fascist government fighting enemy species for something you don't believe in or something you don't know what it is, an arbitrary idea, and just go out and killing things. It's such a delicious topic because it's filled with enjoyment. It has a lot of potential, but it also gives you a chance to reflect on why are you doing this. I mean, the entire somebody described the Helldivers universe as the U.S. foreign policy during the era.
Steroids, yeah. The whole concept I thought was hysterical. Like when the opening video is brilliant, I thought it's just so funny. And then the concept of Super Earth is also hysterical. And then you've got Democracy Strikes Back. You know, the idea of managed democracy. It's just like so corporate and so, like you said, socialist fascism, like turned into some strange, future. It's hilarious. It makes me laugh constantly.
Yeah, and we've had so much fun with that concept because, I mean, at its core, I mean, all the values in Helldivers are things that are usually considered as what is good, the good stuff of society, the glue that holds society together. But I mean, you can use any of these concepts to covertly change the minds of people and make them act in a bad way, and I mean, I've always been a fan of, just fiction in general. Like, I always read fiction books back in the days. I watched a lot of movies. And all of those were based on fiction. But just a couple of years ago, I got my eyes open to, like, politics. And I got really interested in how the world has evolved from politics and how history has affected the where we are today. And even recent history, I mean, like in the last 30 or 40 years. And I sort of started seeing this trend of concepts being twisted and turned to match what the sort of leaders of any given country or ideology or something like that wants to create. And I just had to make a game about it. So Helldivers came from that idea that we need to make a game that is so overt in how it manipulates concepts that we already know about that are seen as good.
Yeah, I mean, it's awesome to see that kind of political commentary. And it's such a hard thing to pull off in video games without being preachy or heavy-handed. There are a lot of games that try to tackle political issues, and frequently they're either, like I said, they're heavy-handed, they're over the top, they're almost not careful enough. Like, I remember they tried to make a series of realistic FPS simulations of actual missions that had happened in the Middle East. Considered very crude and failed because of that. So that's obviously not a way you can tackle political issues in the game. And there are plenty of other games that are, like I said, are too preachy. They're not fun. You're just getting talked at the whole time by someone's beliefs, and it's not interesting. And what you've done, I think, is probably one of the trickier things to do, which is pull off a game that makes political commentary, but is actually more fun to play, so you can ignore any of the political commentary if you want and still enjoy the game. That's a tricky thing to do. I definitely applaud you on that.
Thank you.
It's something I certainly would like to see out of more games in the future, too.
One of the things that we said, one of the first thing that I said when I told the team, like, well, I want to make a political commentary on how you can convert any subject or topic or good thing into a bad thing. Everybody went like, ugh, that sounds boring. I'm like, yeah, but we're not going to make it in a boring way. We're not going to do it in the boring way. Instead, we're gonna make a game where you feel like a badass, but after you've played for like 20 or 30 hours, something like that, you're gonna go like, why am I fighting? What is it really for? Like, this abstract concept that has no... I mean, it doesn't even mean what it's supposed to mean. Like, manage democracy. You can't manage
democracy. It's itself, yeah. I mean, that's itself hypocrisy. You know what I mean? It's...
So, and at the core of everything, I mean, no matter what you want to do with a game, if you want to set, like, get people to open their eyes on a political issue, or if you want to tell them about the weird things about being a wizard in a fantasy world and everybody looks up to you, but you're super dangerous, which means they shouldn't look up to you.
Right.
No matter what you do, what needs to be at the core of each game is a sense of enjoyment. I mean, a game has to be primarily, well, not necessarily like a game, but it has to be an enjoyable experience.
Right.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, do you have any other questions on Helldivers, Cole?
I actually do. There's a few good ones here in the chat. There are a few ones here about the... I guess I'll lump these few all together. They're basically asking, is there any new DLC planned for Helldivers? And if so, do you got... what exactly is in store? Is it like new enemies, new planets, new stratagems, maybe?
Right now, this is so weird. Because when we started doing Helldivers, of course, we had the base game planned. But we knew that with the success of Magicka and the way we expanded on that universe, that we wanted to expand on the Helldivers universe. And that's why we created the expansions and DLCs. And we had, once the Helldivers was released, we created a plan for what new content we wanted to create. We wanted to create Turning Up the Heat, Masters, and Democracy Strikes Back. And after that, we didn't have anything planned, but people keep asking for more stuff for Helldivers. Right now, we're like, well, what should we do? Should we create new stuff? Are we going to create new stuff? So I would love to do that. But it's a luxurious situation to be in. And we just had a meeting this today discussing, like, okay, what are we going to do? I mean, we've released the game on PC. We're working on some extra things. We've done a lot of patches to correct some of the things in the PC release. And also we're going to deploy another patch for the PS4, PS3, and PS Vita sometime soon. Except we lost our connection to the Sony backend, so we can't send the patch to them today. So we have to do it tomorrow. It's like technical issues. Everybody's waiting for a patch, and it's like, oh, can't send it. We don't have a connection to Sony.
No, they're too busy getting denial attacks.
Oh, so, man, that does.
Yeah. So to be frank, we're not entirely sure what we're going to do for Helldivers. It depends on what the community wants. And, I mean, there's a lot of threads and suggestions on what we should do. But we've been thinking about maybe doing additional difficulties, because there's a hardcore fan base of Helldivers that go like, well, difficulty 12 planets aren't difficult enough. It's like, well... Yeah, okay. It's setting enough democracy for us all. So we're looking into it. I mean, it could be anything. Well,
I've got a question for you, though, a little bit along those lines. So you published a remake, developed a remake of Gauntlet. And that is probably the best example I can think of about a game that has been done again and again and again and again. And you'd think maybe every little aspect of Gauntlet had been explored already and that there was nothing left that could be made. So that must have been tricky for you. You know, I imagine people are coming to you saying, oh, we'd like more Helldivers content. Well, I'm sure you've got some ideas where that might go. But someone comes to you and say, hey, we'd like you to remake a 30-year-old game. and do it in a way that's never been done before. That must be really hard. And so I was just, and I don't want to get too deep into it, but I was curious to know how you got the Gauntlet Legends IP, and because I know you got it through Warner Brothers, and so how that came about, and what your thought structure was behind remaking such a classic game.
Okay, basically, we went into a room with a lot of Warner Brothers executives, and I mean proper executives. You know, the ones in Aliens that made guilty of blowing
right,
up.
And the lizard men, the G-men.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah, the G-men. And they would go like, well, you're really young. That's the first thing they said. Wow, you're really young. When me and Emil entered the room, we're like, yeah, sorry.
our bad.
And they talked to us for a bit, saying like, "Well, we really appreciate, we really enjoy what you did with Magicka. We are looking to expand into the digital market." You know, there are a lot of corporate words being used, thrown around lightly.
Oh, yeah.
And they looked at us and said like, "Well, we've got some IPs that we were thinking about doing a new iteration on," and I'm like, okay, well, look at Emil across the table, and I just rolled my eyes and was like, we're not going to remake somebody else's IP. And they start listing IPs, like, one after the other. There's, like, off-brands of what Warner has already released, basically. And we go like, yeah, we're not interested by any of those. And he lists like four or five of those. And then he comes to like, what turns to one of the other execs and go like, what was that other IP? And that guy like, oh, what was it? Oh yeah, it was Gauntlet.
That other IP.
This was of course planned all along, I imagine.
Oh, they messed with art, didn't they?
I look at Emil on the other side of the table and I go like, we use our telepathy that we do sometimes. And I go like, don't fucking freak out. Don't freak out, because we love Gauntlet. Yeah. And after I looked at Emil, I'm like, don't freak out. I paused for like 3 seconds and I go like, Gauntlet! We'll do it! It doesn't matter what you say. We'll do it.
That's awesome.
So we got the IP for Gauntlet and we're like, yeah, okay, so what are we going to do about it? And one of the things that we said at the first meeting we had about what we're going to do about Gauntlet, it was, let's not overcomplicate things. Let's not try to make it into a Diablo clone or any other clone of anything. Let's just make Gauntlet what we thought was fun with Gauntlet. It should be a proper top-down game. Doesn't have to be the like best game in the universe. It just has to be what we remember being the most fun about this precious old classic game that we played back in the days. And that is exactly what we did. We just took everything and brought it into like a new era, or rather, 3 decades later, and just wanted a game where you were 4 heroes, one of each class, went into a dungeon and cut down a ton of zombies and collected a lot of gold. That's all there was to it. And it's like, that's everything we need to do. And let's just do that. Because a lot of times when I see remakes, it's all about like new fancy things and trying to reimagine what it was. And it's just this... I just get tired of it. Because
I agree.
What I want as a Gauntlet fan is something that reminds me of what it felt like playing Gauntlet back in the days. And for new people to understand sort of what Gauntlet was back in the days.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't play the original Gauntlet for NES. I have played it since. My first run in Gauntlet was Gauntlet Legends in the arcade and in N64. And I loved playing that with my friends. That was a blast. And that made me go back and play the older ones, because I later learned it was such a classic. And so then when I saw that you had made it, I knew I had to ask a question about Gauntlet, because it's an absolute classic.
But one of the issues we actually had was the Gauntlet that a lot of people really loved, the Gauntlet Legends and the intermediate games that were not the same as the original Nintendo or the arcade cabinet games. And those people were pretty disappointed with our take on Gauntlet. But that's something we knew already, because those games had evolved from what Gauntlet originally was. but we really wanted just to do a remake of the original Gauntlet and no, like, funny stuff on the side.
Well, Colt, do we have a few more questions for him?
Oh, we sure do. And here's one, actually, because when we start talking about Gauntlet, it kind of really seems like it fits in with the overall Arrowhead kind of je ne sais quoi when it comes to, like, what kind of games you like to make. And that is, it seems to be, like, co-op kind of stuff. And so we have a good one here from Rob606, who's asking, what exactly makes you guys at Arrowhead focus on creating, like, co-op-focused games? Is there, like, some kind of belief there's a lack of these in the market? Or is it just the general kind of love of that? Because I know Helldivers, especially, is almost impossible without the co-op without the co-op element sometimes.
Yeah, it is the co-op nature of games. I mean, when I play myself, I usually play a lot of PvP games. I like, for instance, the new military shooter Squad. If you haven't played that, try that out. It's insane, insane amounts of fun. But the reason why we started making co-op games was because in 2000, and we started making Magicka in like 2008, late 2007. There were basically no co-op games at all. There were a few of them. And we were like, we just want to play co-op games. We just want to sit down and play a co-op game together. That is a lot of fun. And that's when we started developing Magicka. And it just became this thing that we're good at. And we just kept doing it. And I mean, of course, we've tried doing PvP in, for instance, Showdown Effect. But we still get back to the co-op nature of games. And there's something nice about a game that is really, really, really tough. And that you have a really hard time beating on your own. But when you're playing with friends, you have a chance. You stand a chance against this evil kind of AI that is really bothering you. And I think that's... there's something really nice about a couple of friends sitting down and trying to complete something that they can't on their own. And that's just the reason why we kept developing co-op games and probably will continue developing co-op games for the foreseeable future. Since it's just so much fun playing co-op games with friends.
It's one thing I've noticed is that a lot of, you know, when I've interviewed a few developers a number of them have produced co-op games, and I've noticed that developers more than other gamers enjoy playing co-op games. Now, it could be a coincidence, I'm not sure, but I've noticed that a lot of developers really enjoy co-op games, and they end up making a lot of co-op games. And I wonder if the process of beating a co-op game isn't so different than producing the co-op game. In other words, making a game is itself a co-op game.
Getting me on a deep psychological level here.
That's right. And I was wondering if there's any parallel there. You know, the cooperative nature of making a game isn't unlike the cooperative nature of beating a game. Would you say that that's true at all?
You know, I've never thought about it that way, but
Maybe I'm getting a little too philosophical.
No, but it pretty much is the same feeling. Like, when you're a team, and especially when it comes to games development, it is a pretty tough job. I mean, a lot of people envision game developers being, like, sitting in a room, coming up with crazy ideas, and then that's game development. But it's right. Just, usually it's a lot of hard work, and a lot of things that you decide on, like, well, let's just add this thing to a menu. And that has consequences. It has so many consequences. So that something else is not viable. Something else doesn't work. The gamer suddenly has too much information in one screen. Like, we added too many things. Now nobody cares about anything in this splash screen or, well, this scoreboard or whatever. So in that sense, game development is a lot about problem solving and working with everybody else. I mean, a game designer isn't responsible to, well, it's not the game designer's job to make all the decisions about everything. It's about trying to figure out which of the proposed ideas will have the least consequences to everything else in the game. The co-op nature of that, the way we work together as a team, is pretty similar to a really, really, really hard co-op game. In a sense, it could very well be so that developers really want to... But your theory breaks down in one place, though. What game developers don't want to experience this as an enjoy, like as an entertainment.
Right. It's not as fun. There's you don't get that constant feed of loot and praise that a game gives you.
Right.
I know, but I mean, it might be, or it's just the fact that it could be that co-op games always, when you playtest a co-op game, you play it against an AI and you try to beat it and you can tune it. But if you make a PvP game, you have to boot it up and play against the other people at the studio. And that creates a bit of a friction. You want to punch people in the face after you've done that don't work together to solve the issues.
That is true.
I think we got time for maybe like two more questions.
Okay. So trying to get back into Helldivers focus, I guess. People are... speaking of PvP, people are inevitably kind of curious because of, I guess, probably what they saw going on with Wizard Wars. Will there ever be a PvP option for Helldivers? I know it's co-op focused right now, but people, I think on some level they do kind of like to blow up their friends.
As I said previously, I love PvP games, but a PvP element in Helldivers is a stretch. It's probably not going to happen. And as for us making a PvP game sometime in the future, yeah, might happen. Next project is probably going to be a co-op game, although it is going to be a co-op game. But who knows what happens in the future. But we're going to keep on making co-op games. Even though in some co-op games we might have a PvP functionality.
Right. Okay. Well, I mean, it is good to stick to the ethos that served you so well.
I think it's just the realization that there are other people that are better than us at making PvP games. So let them make the PvP games, and we'll keep on providing gamers with the co-op games. So we'll get a nice, even spread of who makes what. Because, I mean, everybody can't be the best at everything. You have to realize some people are supreme in what they do. Like Relic with strategy games, for instance.
Right. That is true. There's always a niche we kind of have to fit into. But, you know, kind of touching on the whole going forward thing, another one from Rob606. He's got some good questions for us today. Mm-hmm. Are you able to really kind of talk about Arrowhead's plans for the future, or is that something that's a little NDA?
It is extremely NDA.
I thought I would ask. Just yes.
Okay, I'm just gonna, since I don't like NDAs. When people visit our studio, we don't sign NDAs. We just let people that we trust in.
We're trustable people.
You and the rest of the web. No, but I mean, if you look at the facts, like Arrowhead makes co-op games, so of course our next game is going to be a co-op game. I've said in interviews previously that we are not going to do two projects simultaneously, meaning that we have 30 developers working on one title. What else have I said? Yeah, that is pretty much it. So, from
there's
that...
30 people working on a game.
Yeah.
That's so, what that
means is that we're going to make a larger title than we've done previously. So, it's going to be our biggest game yet.
Exciting.
Can you tell if it's an original IP or an IP that you picked up from a licensor?
I can't tell you that.
I bet that means it's a licensed IP, folks. Just a hint. maybe not, though. Maybe not.
Guess what?
I let the interweb speculate. I guess if they'll probably be able to find out if they put their heads together. I don't know. I probably shouldn't taunt the internet.
Never taunt the internet. Well, we've had a great interview with you today. We really appreciate you being on with us. Again, I'm just going to read a little recap that Arrowhead Game Studios is an independent Swedish video game developer. It was established in 2008 by a group of Luleå University of Technology students. And today we've had with us Johan Pilestedt, CEO and game director of Arrowhead Game Studios. And Johan, thank you so much for being with us today. It was a really fun discussion. Helldivers is an awesome game. I love playing it. I'll probably play it some more after this interview, in fact, because I only just started yesterday and I'm kind of addicted. Any final remarks?
You have to end on something profound, and that is always an issue. But, I mean, as I always say, to every aspiring game developer out there, since there's a lot of people that really want to work in the games industry, the games industry is not a rock star business. It's not something that is a magical place where you can't go if you're not from the right family or whatever. It's just about learning what you want to do, learning about 3D modeling, level design, regular design or scripting or programming, and then apply for a job and keep applying, because the games industry needs a lot of competent people. So if you're an aspiring game designer, don't be afraid of trying your luck in the games industry.
That's great advice. And I hope young aspiring developers out there right now heard that. Don't give up. Fight for your dreams. Great advice from Johan of Arrowhead Games himself. thanks again for being here with us. We are opnoobs.com, PC gaming by PC gamers. And thanks to all of Twitch who tuned in. And we have another great show on Thursday coming up. It was the Should We Cover It show. Please tune in then. And in the meantime, please go to our website, opnoobs.com, and read the Helldivers review written by our very own Colt. Thank you, Colt, for producing that. And that's all we have for today, folks. We'll see you again next time. Thank you very much for being here.
Have a great one.
Bye-bye.